This is the watchman giving a clarion call, and I'm going to cover something today that should bring a smile to your face and a twinkle to your eye, as things are not faring so well for our banking friends. You see, things are really heating up on the currency and banking scene this week. It's getting explosive. We're getting report after report of too big to jail banksters whose managements are starting to panic behind the scenes due to unexpected, ghastly quarterly reports. Not just bad reports, bloodbath reports. All right. For instance, take Credit Suisse, who, get this, just posted a $5.8 billion loss on the fourth quarter last year. $6 billion. Folks, that's almost as big as the J.P. Morgan London whale fiasco losses just several years ago, at least the part they chose to make public. This brought all of Credit Suisse's 2015 net income to roughly negative $3 billion for the whole year. That's horrid, awful year for a bank of that size. And this absolute horror show brought their share price down to roughly $14.44 per share this week, their lowest in a quarter century. It's unbelievable, especially when you consider this. Remember how Credit Suisse's lowest share price during the entire 2008 financial crisis never broke below $20. Yet here we are, 33% below that figure. Credit Suisse's share price has gone parachuting without a parachute. No big deal, Watchman. The big banks have occasional bad quarters or years. This is just an outlier. Banking's doing great. No. It's not. Consider Exhibit B. Deutsche Bank. Yes, everyone's favorite market rigger who got off the hook from a precious metals manipulation inquiry just several years ago. They're doing their best impression of the Hindenburg right now. Share price is out and out, free-falling. They've hit a new multi-decade low of just over $16. $16! Again, remember back during the last financial crisis, when the world was literally about to shut down. The lowest price tick that they printed was $22 a share. So here's another bank, roughly 30% under their lowest print in the last crisis. Now understand, it's not just about share price, okay? That's just one thing. It's bad enough. Deutsche is having some major problems right now in another realm. Here's what's going on. Behind the scenes, there is some major concerns by big moneyed players in the market that Deutsche Bank is their credit rating is not really all that good. People are beginning to buy serious risk protection against Deutsche Bank's tenable financial situation. Okay, the CDS market, in the credit market for Deutsche Bank is literally going straight up. The cost to insure against risk of Deutsche is going parabolic. Okay, and it right now, it's three times as high to buy, you know, into the CDSs for Deutsche than it was just last March. That's big trouble, okay, because the big money players in the market are finally starting to sense that there's an enormous problem. It's acting like an anchor on the broader stock markets, especially in Europe, where the German DAX was dragged beneath the waves yesterday as fears of Deutsche's failing health were weighing on everyone's minds. Remember, they have one of the largest derivative positions on Earth, many tens of trillions of dollars. Okay, this is happening all over Europe, from Monte Paschi in Italy to Deutsche. The entire European financial scene is being pulled down in an ugly undertow. And remember, this is the craziest part. nothing has even happened yet. At least nothing anyone is admitting to. There have been no failures. There have been no large bankruptcies. You know, nothing has happened in the derivatives world, yet banks are already printing these multi-decade low prices, and the CDS protection is going straight up. Now, imagine what will happen at the first whiff of a real crisis, of a derivative bet gone wrong, of a huge looming credit downgrade, or even a bankruptcy. You think banking looks wretched now? Oh, just you wait. It's going to be a horror show. It truly is. And you'd think, with all the awful news out there, that the U.S. dollar would be soaring. But it's not soaring. It's crashing hard. The U.S. dollar index, which was roughly at 100 at the beginning of the week, in the last 3 days, has fallen to the low of just over 96. That's a near 3% to 4% lower than it was just 3 or 4 days ago. All right, the dollar took out some key short-term support 2 days ago, especially when it fell. I mean, it cratered pretty hard through that short-term support. Folks, it's one thing for a stock or gold or silver or any other, you know, regular, you know, commodity out there or equity to have those kinds of price swings. It is totally another thing for the U.S. dollar to do this. Okay, the de facto currency, reserve currency of the world, and it's trading like a freaking penny stock. Okay, this has had a fairly profound impact on gold and silver prices throughout the week, as many of the commercial shorts, the tech shorts, who've just been pouring on the short side, have had to do some decent covering. Okay, it's provided a bit of a pop in gold and silver, with gold hitting roughly $1,160, and silver just shy of $15. And yes, that's nice to see indeed. But I want to say two things here to our stacking community. I want to keep it real. Firstly, we're coming up to the short-term chart resistance on these prices in gold and silver. And pretty soon, historically, is when I'd expect the banks to start hitting the brakes on these price rises, or at least try to. Remember, price rises in precious metals only occur after the banks feel they've taken them about as low as they can on the current price cycle. Once the banks have covered adequate shorts and obtained the longs that they wanted, they allow price to rise in order to cash in the newly acquired long contracts so they can clip the wings of those uppity hedge funds who just went long against them. Now, when they've covered those longs and let the price rise, they start applying heavily on the short side again, time after time after time. That has been the way that they have brought about this contrived 4- and 5-year downtrend. They do this over and over. It's how the rigging works, and the COT always gives important clues as to what's going on. Now, I'd imagine that's where we are, and historically, fairly soon, the bankers could get ready to bring down the hammer. So just be ready if that happens. Secondly, there are a few voices out there who are saying, that's it, we've seen the bottom. $10.50 in gold and $13.50 in silver was absolutely the bottom. Now, maybe, brothers, maybe, but sadly, some of these folks saying that were the voices that said $1,525 was the bottom in gold, or $1,400, or $1,200, or even $1,080 were the bottom in gold as well. And they've said the same thing in silver. They're still saying the same thing now. $10.50 in gold is just too strong a price support to break. Too strong. Look. These people don't learn. Hear me now. There is no such thing in gold and silver as strong price support. You are literally believing in the Easter Bunny if you say that. If you think that. Okay. Brother, it's a mirage. The cabal can take prices literally anywhere they want. If the bankers wanted to take gold down, you know, several hundred dollars in several days or even one evening, they could do it. Likewise in silver, remember, they've taken silver down 15% in minutes in a flash crash before. They could certainly do so again anytime they wanted. Watchmen, I don't get it. If they can do that, what good is all of our stacking? Ah, you see, that's the limits of their power, brother, and this is key. Always remember this. They can take prices anywhere they want, but they cannot sustain prices anywhere they want, and they well know it. If they take gold's price that low, they lose hundreds or thousands of tons of gold in a literal snap. Remember, that's gold that they don't likely have to feed into the market at this point anymore. They'd also lose many millions of extra silver ounces within hours, and perhaps tens of millions of extra ounces within as little as a month's time. If they took silver down in another such flash crash on the May Day massacre like we had before, I would expect the COMEX cliff dive to end with a severe splat on the pavement, okay? So here's all I'm suggesting, all the Shear brothers do. Don't get your hopes up. Be professional. Stay focused on the goal, which is obtaining more ounces. Do not focus on the price, okay? There's a verse in Scripture in the New Testament, in Matthew, which basically says you cannot even add one hair to your head by worrying. Okay, likewise, for stackers, you cannot move the price bar even one tick with all the wishing, with all the hoping, and with all the anxiety in the world. So let it go. You'll exhaust yourself doing it. All right, listen, enjoy the green days. That's fine. But mentally prepare and harden yourself for red days. Lots of red days. If they don't happen, great. If they do, you aren't even scratched. They don't touch the paint. Because they'll likely do this, I suspect, until the system snaps. And ladies and gentlemen, if the banking sector's crash doesn't stop soon and have some meaningful reverses, it may mean that that day of the crash is not too long off. This is the Watchman signing out. Stay vigilant and bring the fight to them.